Thank you all for being here, and thank you all for your physical distancing today. I'm going to make a couple of comments, but I want to save most of the time for questions from the media. These are unusual circumstances, and so we have to be creative in terms of the way that we can answer questions from you. So I just want to reiterate what I've stated in my video this morning, that this is the 11th day of the City of Kamloops being operated through an emergency operations center. And we were pleased yesterday that Minister Farnworth, the Solicitor General, issued some ministerial orders that will allow us to be nimble and react quickly to this ever-changing emergency within our city. He also has allowed for virtual council meetings, and I can tell you that I was speaking with council yesterday, and they are anxious to get back to work, but restrictions within the community charter were preventing that, so we will ask our corporate officer to put in place our capacity to hold public meetings. Now, the city's still running. I was pleased that our police, our fire, our water, our sewer system, our sanitary garbage pickup system is still running. I spoke with Superintendent Leckie as early as an hour ago, and there is a spate in property crime within the community, about a 20% increase. This is a disturbing trend, and I would certainly hope that we would be able to use our police resources for those kinds of events rather than some of the less consequential things that are going on. Superintendent Leckie tells me all the watches are covered, as does our Chief Adams, in terms of our staffing complements in those organizations. We have had, just like every other business in Kamloops, to make some very difficult decisions with respect to staffing. We had to issue 100 layoff notices to part-time employees within the city and contractors within the city. That is very disappointing for us, because these are people that in normal times help make Kamloops shine, and you know them. But we are continuing to look at our operations. Most of our employees are working from home. There's just a skeleton staff in City Hall working at home, myself. The EOC is really where all the action happens, and I provided you yesterday with some gallery photographs of the operation. We have had, over the last 24 hours, a number of inquiries of bylaw services. The minister indicated that bylaw officers would be around enforcing some of the orders of the provincial health officer. And they do, in some contexts, provide wellness checks to street-affected individuals within the city of Kamloops, and they're going to continue to do that. This is not an issue about finding and arresting people. Many of the people that we see congregating are not people who would have the means to pay a fine anyway, nor are they people that we want to incarcerate, nor do we have the capacity to incarcerate people. So I think this is an effort where education is our biggest tool. And I want to, with that, thank the citizens of Kamloops for their commitment to social isolation, or social distancing, as they call it, or I think physical distancing is the new term, because it is helping, as Dr. Henry said, bend this curve in British Columbia and here in Kamloops. So, that was certainly something that the vast majority of our residents are adhering to those recommendations, and I thank you for them. I also want to give a huge shout out, as well as council wants to give a huge shout out to those that are working in healthcare facilities within our city, obviously Royal Inland Hospital, but many of the other facilities in the city that, you know, Overland Exempt Care, Ponderosa Lodge, all of those facilities are working under extreme pressure during these times. And what you can do to help a healthcare worker, please do that. We have had a lot of people using our waste dumps, our Mission Flats facility. We want to make sure that people have access to that, because right now people are spending a lot of time in their yards, they're pruning and cleaning things up. But please, when you do go to those facilities, make sure that the physical distancing requirements are kept intact, and we are going to be making some further changes to our transit system. I told you earlier in the week that we had adjusted our schedules, and next week we may adjust them even more. Early indication is that our ridership, even without having fares, is about 35% of where it would be. So we're going to be looking at some further contraction of that service, as well as putting a maximum capacity on those people that can be on buses, simply to maintain that physical distance requirement there. And I want to speak about our state of local emergency that expired at noon today. And we put that in place a week ago because we wanted to be able to react to this emerging situation here in Kamloops. Yesterday, the minister brought some orders on the order paper in British Columbia that take care of that. So we're not doing that here in Kamloops. And as I stated in my conference earlier, on my video earlier, people shouldn't feel that they're stuck at home. They should believe that they're safe at home. And so I encourage you to maintain that level of staying away if you don't have to. If people need to go shopping, send one person out to do that shopping, and try to minimize the number of people that are on our streets. And certainly by my movement around the city, that is happening. So I'll take your questions now.
In terms of
Jeff Andreas.
In terms of people who are concerned, I guess, about, you know, if they're looking out their window and they see people not abiding by social distancing rules, I know where they're supposed to call, so they can call this bylaw, and like, what is the role of people who are actually paying attention to the rules?
Well, remembering family units can be together. They're together in their home, so they can be together when they're on the street. And, you know, I don't think that's something that we want people phoning in and trying to measure from their window. The vast majority of Kamloops residents are complying with this. Where we do see some indications where that is not happening, our bylaw officers have, through this latest ministerial order, been given the right to go and to counsel them with respect to the importance of physical distancing and how that will help take the peak in terms of admissions at Royal Inland Hospital off and help flatten this curve with the Kamloops context. Next question.
Are you expecting any more layoffs?
Well, you never say never, but you know, we have a very valuable workforce within the city of Kamloops, as I said, most of whom are working at home. But there are circumstances where your job is such that you can't work from home. If you're a museum curator and the museum's closed, you have a difficulty there. If you're a TCC person and TCC is closed, we have a difficulty there. We have been using our staff to do some of the projects that we have hoped to do in these sites, the nice-to-do things that we never get around to, so that's happening. We've also been using our staff to do deep cleaning of the facilities that were open to the public a while ago, so that when we do reopen, the public can be assured they're safe. Next question.
How do you, it's very troubling and concerning for people around the world, how can you reassure Kamloops residents? Are people calling you, warning, or what message are you giving to people to try and calm them down and let them know that everything is being done as possible?
Yeah, and that's something. I mean, we see these surreal images every night on television, and you know, you look at the trouble that New York City is currently in, and you know, with emergency planning, you plan for the worst and you hope for the best. And I think in Kamloops, the fact that we had a pandemic plan in place, the fact that we were on it early, has helped us. But as I said 2 weeks ago at my State of the City address, with a novel virus, you are not going to be able to avoid it. So you just have to try to manage it. And I think, and certainly at this point in time, and listening to the minister and Dr. Henry just moments ago about their projections, I think that we are in pretty good shape in Kamloops, but we are preparing for the worst. So I think that's prudent emergency management.
When it comes to the
over here, thank you.
When it comes to the now being under a provincial state of local emergency, a state of emergency instead of a state of local emergency, does that change anything in terms of restrictions or measures that the city has specifically put in place that maybe the province hasn't, when we think of things like Hillside Stadium being closed on Tuesday?
No, and the question was, is there a significant difference between the provincial state of emergency and a state of local emergency? No, I took the advice of our EOC a week ago because they felt it was necessary to have a state of local emergency because there wasn't that kind of opportunity within the provincial system to do the kind of things that they felt necessary to protect the citizens of Kamloops. I signed that, not without a lot of hesitation, but I did so in good faith that that was the best decision, and I'm confident now that it was the best decision for the citizens of Kamloops. I think the government has stepped up to the plate, and they have really, this week, I had a conference call with Solicitor General on Monday, spoke with the Minister of Municipal Affairs, Selena Robinson, in her office on Tuesday, and yesterday they came out with a number of ministerial orders that will essentially allow us to do the same thing. Kamloops matters.
Hi. Ken, what have you heard from the local business community? Today, the federal government announced it's increasing its wage subsidy by 75%. Here in Kamloops, are lots of businesses telling me, hey, we're probably going to end up closing, or what's the consensus?
I have heard from businesses in Kamloops, and I think it's just been reminded of the question. The question was, what have I heard from businesses in Kamloops about the current economic situation? I've heard from businesses specifically, and I've heard from business organizations that this is a very difficult time. And as we speak about COVID-19 and the public health crisis that it's created, the wave behind that is an economic crisis. And I am very concerned for the local economy. I am very concerned for those that rely on the hospitality and tourism sector. And so we need to be nimble, as I said earlier, in terms of our approach to that. There's a Kamloops Strong initiative that Tourism Kamloops are spearheading with a number of organizations, and the city is participating in that. I have been musing aloud about the Mayor's Task Force for Economic Recovery that I would like to host in terms of getting some of the thought leaders together figure out a way out of this current situation. But these are unprecedented in terms of the numbers of closures that we have seen, and certainly the restrictions, and in particular on those in the hospitality industry. Next question, Maria.
Has the city received any more direction from the ministry about possible property tax deferral?
The question is about property tax deferral. I had anticipated that question. I checked with the minister about 2 hours ago. There still is nothing. I raised it with her last week. I raised it again with her. The matter of property tax deferral rests with the ministry, not with the city of Kamloops. It's kind of enshrined within the legislation. We want to do what's right by the citizens of Kamloops. But again, we have a payroll to meet, just like everybody else, so that, well, it sounds good and council could be patted on the back for deferring utility fees and deferring taxes. At the end of the day, we have 750 employees that rely on us paying them every 2 weeks, just like many other businesses do. So this is a difficult decision, and I've talked to council about that. Dennis Walsh, that chairs our finance committee, along with Councillor Bill Sarai and Councillor Michael Riley, and they are busy looking to our finance director to provide some recast of our budget so that we will be able to get back to work in this new context and figure out where we are with the tax increase, where we are with taxation, where we are with utility burden. Next question. Jeff Andreas, Stingray.
So with the province basically with their state of emergency, now cities have to find other facilities in case there is issues. Is the city not by identifying what facilities can be used in case of availability of this question?
The question is about emergency facilities to expand the capacity of Royal Inland Hospital. Yes, our plan identifies a number of those emergency facilities, things like the conversion of the Sandman Center, the conversion of the TCC would come to mind. There's also, some other facilities within the community that could be put into play. Those decisions would be made by the EOC on the request of the Interior Health Authority.
In terms of work happening for capital projects, I'm curious if you know specifically what the restrictions in place on social distancing, et cetera, mean for the Trunkheel Road sewer project there, what it means for the Royal Inlet Hospital expansion project as well, and anything else you can comment on in general?
Yeah, so the question from Colton Davies at Stingray Radio is in and around issues related to capital projects. The expansion project led by Ellis Don at Royal Inland Hospital is still ongoing. The construction continues. The Valley View School project is still ongoing. Those things are still up and running. The question really is about our capital budget and what things do we need to do because they're time sensitive and urgent for the safety and security of the community, things like flood protection, backup power to the water system. I think those were two on the books. Those need to continue to happen, but what are some of the projects that could be deferred to perhaps allow us not to have such a financial crunch that we are anticipating and relate to this decision? So as you know, Mr. Crumwell is our capital projects manager, and Mr. Trowett and Ms. Humphrey, our chief financial officer, are working with him in terms of that long list of capital projects to see which might be deferred. There's no sense starting a big project if you can't finish. So you don't want to take the roof off the Canada Games pool only to find out you don't have the supplies necessary to put it back together again. So all of those things really need to be thought through in this circumstance, because there is limited access to shipping and transportation. Yeah, you know, there's been, the question has been, sorry, it's a tough thing to get used to. The question is about the relationship with the Interior Health Authority, and, you know, I don't think it, in the times of a crisis it's really good to point fingers at anybody that's, in or out of the EOC and whether or not you're satisfied with the job that they're doing. I think what you're seeing now is the consequence of a decision made a decade ago by the Interior Health Authority to leave the city of Kamloops, a city of 100,000 people, without a medical health officer to deal with the city and to deal with a tertiary hospital like Royal Inlet Hospital. They actually had made moves to correct that situation back in January, and they have an ad out for a medical health officer. But, you know, the medical health officers are the people that lead communities and institutions through these types of situations, and it's unfortunate we don't have one. But certainly last night I received a call from Susan Brown, the CEO of the Interior Health Authority, with respect to the situation at Save-On Foods prior to that becoming public. So they are improving since the Sportsman Bonds meal situation that there was a lot of dissatisfaction with to last night's announcement. I think they're getting the message, and we're going to work through this together with them. Dan Sutherland, our emergency manager that I introduced you to earlier this week, he liaises with them on a daily basis, and so that is helping in terms of communication. Next question.
The city closed up at 3M, mentioning that there was compliance issues there with social distancing measures. Has the city received any other complaints or issues around social distancing, or are people getting tested?
Yeah, the question is around social distancing and Hillside Stadium. That was unfortunate that, you know, there was a number of people that were continuing to use that facility to play soccer and to walk in clumps around in the outside track. The staff indicated to me that it was a problem, and so we made that decision on their recommendation to close it. And we won't hesitate to close other facilities if that becomes a problem. But today I drive by the Juniper Ridge Dog Park, and I see I think there were six dog owners standing at least 2 meters apart and paying attention to that. And I have not observed personally any further exceedances, but where our staff do, they would make a recommendation to the EOC, and we would continue to close facilities. You you know, we want people to be able to get outdoors, but just by themselves or with their family units, I think it's healthy for people to be outdoors, and it's a good distraction from being kind of holed up at home. And I know that's something that our family would want, and I would hope that for the rest of the families in the city.
With things changing daily, hourly, how is the staff holding up?
Our staff at the EOC are doing good. We have redundancy built into our EOC in terms of having two people capable of doing each position. And so, you know, that's how EOCs are built and developed, and that's the way it's working. And you know, when I see them from time to time, they seem to be in pretty good shape. And I think all of our positions are held. You know, it's those people that are providing essential services that we are concerned about. Our water treatment plant operators, for instance, we need to make sure that we have some redundancy in that position and those positions there. And as I mentioned at the outset, the watches within Kamloops Fire and Rescue and the Kamloops Police Office are very important to the continuous safe operation of our city.
When it comes to Brotherland Hospital, hospitalization and where other than that hospital. I'm just curious what you know about the COVID-19 pandemic situation at our local hospital there.
Yeah, I have not had any official communication from the Interior Health Authority with respect to that. Last night I asked Susan Brown how things were going at Royal Inland Hospital, and she said that they were fine. And so I take that on its face value, and they assume that they have invoked their pandemic plan at the hospital, and they are functioning in accordance with that plan.
Fire departments as well. Obviously, the calls still come in. Scanner going all day yesterday for overdose calls, it seemed like. What do you hear from the fire chief and other top-ranking captains, chiefs with the fire department about the situation that they're facing?
Yeah, I was concerned in the last 48 hours. There seemed to be a little bit more activity, but you know, I think because there's no public downtown, some of the activity that you see on the street is a bit amplified, and that is a concern. So I asked the superintendent. I think we've had 5 overdose calls in the last period since the COVID-19 situation erupted, but that just goes to reiterate an issue that is an insidious issue on the streets of Kamloops. You've heard me speak about it before, and that just because there's a pandemic, mental health and addiction issues do not go away. So we have a part of our population that are really suffering, and I think as a community, we need to be as charitable as we possibly can towards their very unique needs in this time.
In terms of city business, trying to continue as normal with council meetings, obviously you guys have amended the bylaw, correct me if I'm wrong, to hold video meetings. So, you know, when the first video conference council meeting would be there?
So we haven't amended the bylaw, and the question was in and around the application of the new rules to allow video council meetings. Have not amended the bylaw because we have not met to do so, and I don't think under this new ministerial order we would have to. The ministerial order allows us to meet electronically to deal with emerging issues related to response to the COVID-19 pandemic and any financial issues related thereto. I think that's the wording. I just read it about an hour ago. So that would be a very unique kind of council meeting. We're not going to be, you know, receiving the annual report from the DES department or talking about some of the things we might normally talk about. These are unusual times. Those issues are still out there, but they're going to have to wait until we're able to go to the regular council meeting. Two more. Jeff Andreas, Stingray Radio.
You said you'd spoken with earlier. Just curious, have they gotten a lot of calls of people concerned about social distancing, and is that really the place people should be calling? Should they be calling 911 or something like that?
Absolutely not. Don't be calling 911 with issues related to social distancing or physical distancing, as they wanted to talk about it. Those issues are not emergencies. 911 has to be clear for emergency calls. People should be talking to either the Interior Health Authority and the health protection team there, or they could call our bylaw services team. But again, let's be a little bit discerning in terms of the kind of calls people make. If you see a group of people playing football, that's probably something. If there's a bush party with tiny kids at it, that's probably something we should look at. But four people walking 5 feet apart instead of six is really not an issue that we're going to spend time on. Last question.
Maybe just give an idea with the province, what they announced yesterday for bylaw services, what the enhanced role will be, those powers, and what the city wants its bylaw department to focus.
You're going to make Mr. Trowin really happy. The question was about the enhanced powers, and I think Mr. Trowin has a copy of the ministerial order for you to take, and you can read that. There seems to be some inconsistency between what the minister said about the ability to fine, because as we've looked at the actual order, it doesn't say that there is an ability to fine in there, but that's really not the way you get through this situation. The ability to fine is notion. The real issue is to educate and make people understand why they need to comply at this particular time. Thank you very much for being here. As the situation warrants, our communication division will organize another opportunity. And thank you all for the work that you do to keep the residents of Kamloops informed. I think that it's a tremendous responsibility that the media carries, and you carry as well. Thank you.